Hey friends, Azure Cache for Redis Enterprise is a low-latency, high-throughput data storage solution for modern applications. There's some exciting new features now in preview that not only improve developer efficiency, but also enhance security and scale. Our special guest, Sean Noyes from Redis, is here to show me what's new today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Sean Noyes from Redis. How's it going, sir?
It's going very well. Hi, Scott. Thank you for having me. And hello, everybody.
Yeah, this is cool. So you work for Redis and you're here to talk about Redis. So this is going to work out nicely.
I am. Yeah. So we have, you know, this first party product that's available in Azure that's part of a co-engineering effort between Azure and Redis. So we provide this joint engineering as well as joint support for the Azure Cache for Redis Enterprise or Acre products.
Interesting. So what does that mean, joint engineering? Like, I don't mean to minimize things, but someone who's watching might say, well, aren't they just running Redis inside Azure?
Yeah, well, so, you know, in order to access the APIs that do governance for a fully managed service, you know, we have to coordinate very closely with the Azure engineering teams, as well as coordinate with the teams who are actually implementing the open source versions of Azure Cache for Redis on Azure. So in order to have this service that offers these enterprise tier you know, features, then we have a very close connection with those folks, and they actually do a lot of engineering side by side on the product.
That's cool. So then that means that it's the very best Redis doing the very best high throughput, low latency on Azure because you talked to the Azure engineers and you know how to make that as work.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have product engineers on the Azure side who are working very closely with the same product managers and engineers on Redis, and those folks are in near constant contact.
Very cool. All right. Do you have a demo?
I do have a demo. So we do have these new features. A lot of things have changed since we launched this product. It launched a few years ago, and we've done several things. Some of the things I won't get into, but you know, there are these extended data types in Redis Enterprise. For instance, JSON, which allows you to granularly pull JSON documents and also to update JSON documents without having to serialize and deserialize the entire payload up and down the wire. So it's very convenient, and I would recommend that users look into these modules because they're extremely powerful. So I'm just going to kind of walk through here a setup. I already kind of started this one. We've added in some information here. You can see I selected Redis Search because I want to have this in my cluster. We have zone redundancy, of course. We can enable or disable TLS access. But some of the new things that we have right in preview, we have data persistence. So you can do a snapshot of RDB, a 60-minute, 6-hour, 12-hour snapshots, which get put into a storage account. We can also do append-only files, which are more accurate, but take longer for a restoration, obviously, because they are more accurate. And you can do those always write or write every second. Of course, we have active geo-replication, which launched at the beginning of last year. And this is for multi-regional setups. So we do an eventual consistency, last write wins, approach toward the Redis clusters. And it's very simple to set this up. You just go in, you click configure, and then you can just add it to a group, or you can create a new group and you just click configure and it joins that group automatically. So that becomes a very attractive thing for customers when they're doing multiple deployments in regions, because of course you can get local latency for your Redis, but still have the added comfort of knowing that your data is available in another region in the event of regional outage.
Speaking of outages, so the RDB format, the Redis database format, is the binary format for Redis, but then AOF is the append-only file format. What are the differences between those two?
The differences between the files themselves are really not that great. You know, effectively, the RDB is just a snapshot of what is in RAM for Redis, and whereas the AOF is all the commands that have come in to write to Redis.
I see. So like an audit log, and that gets saved to Azure storage. Then if there's a catastrophic failure, you can reconstruct all those things with those stored writes.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's something that's done through, you know, through support at Microsoft. Kind of related to this is this customer managed key encryption, which is something we didn't have previously. A lot of customers ask for it. There's a lot of security concerns. In order to get approved to use Redis Enterprise, we needed to have this ability to manage your own keys. Previously, those were Microsoft provided keys. So you effectively have to you create an assigned identity. You have a key vault that you would have stood up. You select the key that you have in your key vault, and then you can just assign the version to it and apply that. So any data at rest then will be encrypted with your own key. So that's very important to a lot of, especially, you know, extremely security-minded customers. And we are talking about the data at rest. So that would be the RDB and the AOF files. We have a couple of other features here. We're just going to go ahead and get rid of this. I've stood up this cluster. This is just a persistence cluster. We have something very cool. So for active geo-replication, we've just allowed the ability to send a flush command into the Redis Enterprise clusters that are participating in active. That's something I think not a lot of customers, we didn't expect customers to use in production, but when customers are testing or they're doing internal benchmarking, it's very convenient for them to say, you know what, we want to flush all the keys, not just from this cluster, but from everything that's participating in the active group. So another thing that we have that's currently in preview is scaling. Now, in this case, we're scaling up, right? So you can see across the top, it says the best practice is to scale up before scaling out. And the reason for this is because customers think in terms of like the open source Redis, where scaling out is really your solution, where you are expecting to get more shards and you expect better for performance. But of course, open source Redis is all single threaded, and Enterprise has that kind of extra tier where we're doing pipeline and multiplexing to take advantage of all the cores on any node within the Redis Enterprise cluster. So one of the things we see with customers is that if they're having, you know, connection slowdown, or they're having connection pool exhaustion, or they're experiencing really high CPU, that scaling up is really a good solution for them. And you can scale up. In this case, this is an Enterprise E10, which is a 12 gigabyte cache, and you can scale up into any of these other tiers. And that's just a click of a button, you save it, and it happens behind the scenes. It stands up another Redis cluster, and then migrates the keys over to it, updates DNS, and your clients resume connecting as normal.
Can you pull that down again? What's the starting and where's the ending? Like, how big can this get?
So right now, in this case, these are Enterprise E10s. This one is an E10. Now, we have Enterprise on Flash too, but I don't necessarily want to get into that right now. But right now we have these four SKUs available. You can get to, so the base with two nodes, that's a primary and a secondary node, is going to be 100 gigabytes. You can expand that to 10, which is actually going to be five primaries. So that's 500 gigabytes. However, we are about to launch probably next quarter an E5, which will be half of that E10, and an E200, which will be double the E100 in size. And of course, we're talking about a lot of RAM there, especially if you start doing multiple node clusters, you know, 10 node clusters with five primaries. We're looking at about a terabyte there. Enterprise on Flash can go up to, right now, it's 13 terabytes as configured in the portal. Although from what I understand, they've been testing configurations up to 29 terabytes.
Wow, but it's definitely going to be able to handle anything I can throw at it.
That's absolutely true. You know, the extra cores that you get on those Enterprise VMs really, really makes a difference in terms of ops per second and the amount of connections you have available. You know, open source has a problem where there can be network back pressure, and there could be pressure because those single threaded shards can only support so many writes and reads on any given shard. So you do experience sometimes network back pressure with the open source shards, which we get around with our proxy tier available at that enterprise level.
And even if I'm doing 100 gigs, the latency is still going to be near zero. That's what Redis is so well known for.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, in the event that we're looking at, you know, 100,000 ops per second or something, you know, extremely high, scaling out and making more shards available for writing, as well as taking advantage of the ability to multiplex and pipeline against those shards, greatly increases throughput.
Now, if I'm doing local testing on this, if I'm using maybe open source Redis, or I spin up Redis locally here, and I'm writing using the libraries that I'm used to be using as a developer, I'm just talking to Redis. And if I go and point it to Redis in the enterprise, it's going to continue to just work, right? Because Redis is Redis. It's just
Redis
more
is Redis.
Cloud.
It is 100% backward compatible. The only difference in terms of coding would be if you are experimenting with using the Redis modules.
Okay, and then a module would be an API that is going to be specific to that module, and then that would need to be also local on my machine if I were going to try to do that.
Yeah, so in Azure, we have Redis Bloom, we have Redis Time Series, Redis Search, and Redis JSON, which I mentioned before. It's something interesting that a lot of customers are doing right now with Redis Search is that we do vector similarity search natively from within Redis. So if you have AI models and you have files, you can process those through your AI models. You can capture those vectors, store them in Redis, and then query against them using Redis Search at that very, very low latency.
Very cool. And then Redis JSON is literally going to let me persist my objects. And is it making it like a document store instead of a name value pair store?
Absolutely. You can store large JSON documents. And again, you can access these on a granular level. So you don't have to pull down the entire document. If you need one particular facet of a large JSON document, you can just pull that single value. Or you can pull an array of values off of multiple keys, multiple documents, just to see how a bunch of different documents might compare. And conversely, you can do those updates in place. So if you just need to update one facet of a JSON document, you can run a command. It's a JSON path-like, you know, very, very familiar type of query language for that. So, you know, customers who've, you know, use JSON or are using JSON in their client apps are going to be very familiar with how they would access the data from within their JSON documents.
If I'm implementing Redis for Enterprise in my enterprise, I probably already have an existing database. Do you think about Redis as a cache, or it is an in-memory database? Is it something that you expect is going to augment my existing data stores, or should I consider it as a database in its own right?
Well, typically customers look at it initially as a cache. You know, that's where a lot of developers come to it. That's where I came to it. That's probably where you came to it initially. Like, let's just cache sessions, for instance. But then really with these extended data types and all of the other native data types available for Redis, like streams, you can implement this as an in-memory database. We do have something on our roadmap, which I'll kind of tease out right now, which is that we're going to provide the ability to monitor streams and key spaces within the Redis so that you can do triggers for Azure functions. So this will allow us to get some isolation against the code, which we're doing write behinds and read throughs in our code. And you could actually just kick off functions in order to, you know, have an RDBMS or a source of truth database while utilizing Redis as an in-memory database for all of your other needs.
Yeah. And what's interesting is this rise of the multimodal database, right? You're storing all this index and indexing all this information, not just in one model, but it's a relational database. It's a document database. It's a graph database. Like, it's with the plugins and the add-ons, Redis is really whatever you need it to be.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, again, there are so many different native data structures that, you know, even, you know, augmenting for time series data, like that's a really big deal because the time series module does aggregation on the fly. So in the event that you have like an edge use case or an IoT use case where you do have lagging data, you don't have to rerun these batch processes, which you know, development teams have had to write over and over again every time new data comes in order to make it more human readable. And, you know, to make it analyzable, all you have to do is tell Redis, hey, watch this key and make aggregations off of it and downsample to whatever time frame you want.
Yeah, that's a great point. And then you mentioned Redis Bloom, B-L-O-O-M. That adds a whole other series of data structures that one can use. So like it's kind of infinitely extensible, and the data structures that are included with Redis Bloom on Redis for Enterprise are pretty sophisticated.
Yeah, they are. They are. The probabilistic data types, you know, they tell you whether something's probably in the cache or definitely not in the cache, depending on how you set that up. But, you know, it's great. We have a lot of customers who use it for, you know, for things like checking IPs, like has this IP ever been used before? They can very, very quickly, sub-millisecond latency, find out from Redis whether or not we have seen this IP address before, right? And so then you can easily apply that to any secondary processes. If you say, no, we haven't seen it, well, then there could be a secondary process that would, that is kind of made unnecessary if you get, yes, it's probably here in this cache.
And this is software as a service. So I'm assuming I don't need to upgrade it. I don't have to think about maintenance. You know, are there downtimes? Are there maintenance windows?
Maintenance and patching are all done by the Azure team. There maybe were some initial, you know, hiccups when the service first launched, but we've gone through those and we've gotten over those humps. We haven't had any significant issues in terms of outages related to those things. So at this point, it is, you know, 100% managed service. We will be offering maintenance windows. Some customers have said, hey, we just want to be sure that you're not doing patching. Because there can be some slowdown on those nodes when they're patching. Of course, they do them round robin, but customers have asked for that, and that's on our roadmap for, I believe, sometime this year.
Very cool. So some of these features in preview, but folks can access them right now, right? They can go up and sign up today.
Yeah, absolutely. None of this is in private preview. It's all in public preview. So if customers want to go in and kick the tires, it's as simple as going out to your Azure portal.
So I already have this. See, this is the thing I love doing about Azure Friday is that I find out that I already have access to something cool, and then I can finish the show up and then think about how I'm going to go and implement this on one of my projects today.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I mean, that's what we talk to our customers about all the time. You know, it's so simple to stand up. You know, in 15 minutes, you can have a Redis Enterprise cluster and start using it.
Very cool. Azure Cache for Redis Enterprise, low latency, high throughput. Thanks so much, Sean Noyes, for hanging out with us today.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
I am learning all about Azure Cache for Redis Enterprise today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.